Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with John Romanoff, James Gaw, Joe Sib, Nick Griffin. This week's host, Mary Lynn Rajskub. Gotham Comedy Live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Mary Lynn Rajskub!
Hey everybody, welcome to Gotham Comedy Live. Good evening. Hi, I'm your host, Mary Lynn Rajskub. Wow, you guys are fantastic. We have some amazing comedy for you tonight. I'm so excited to be here. I usually go to bed at like 9, so this is cool. I like to wind down at like 4:30 p.m., get into the PJs, so this is exciting. It's like a whole new day started. Oh, also, I almost didn't make it here, you guys. I'm addicted to the GPS on my iPhone. Like, even if I'm going a short distance, I have to stare at the dot, you know, make sure I'm going the right way. So I'm like, turn left, turn right, make a U-turn. And I looked up, and I was still on my porch. It's like, oh, I gotta get here. I can't let these people down, you know? But it's okay. It's okay to be confused sometimes. My life is good. The other day, I woke up from a powerful nap, and I looked around, and I was like, you know what? I have a really nice house. And then I realized I had fallen asleep in Pottery Barn. It was still pretty nice. Yeah, I really have to focus. I get confused like when I'm at the airport, just like get to the gate, just because if I even smell Cinnabon, I'm missing my flight, right? So I feel proud of myself. A lot of people recognize me from this show 24 that I was on. Oh, you've heard of it? It's not really a funny show. Not very funny at all. For those of you that don't know, it's about a impending terrorist attack that takes place over 24 hours. Everybody knows what the show is, right? I play a and you guys are like, what? Why is Chloe on stage right now? What is she? Why hasn't she pulled out the schematics yet? Here's the thing. I'm not really a computer genius, guys. I actually started in stand-up comedy, and usually the more I talk, the more people are like, wow, she isn't a computer genius at all. I've been on the road recently, and I always get those couples, like the one has to convince the other, like, well, I don't know. I've never seen her smile before. Honey, let's just go. I think it'll be good. Well, I don't know. And then one time I was going to the bathroom before a show. You know, it's a little ritual I have, a little pre-show good luck tinkle. And this woman, like, clutched my arm, and I turned around. She had tears in her eyes. She's like, you have to save Jack from the Russians. She was deadly serious. And I just said, I will try. But you know that's not real, right? That just means I'm a good actress. What's up, you guys? Just tooting my own horn. Yeah, I've never hacked into any governmental files. Nor have I stopped a nuclear bomb using my computer. In fact, I'm always on the show like really intense, but really what I'm doing on that computer is typing affirmations. So, you know, all the crap will be hitting the fan and I'm like, I'm on it. You look really pretty today, Mary Lynn. I'm going as fast as I can. You're doing a really good job acting. Keep up the good work. Don't take Kiefer's intensity so personally. He really does like you. He's just acting. It helps me get through the day, you know? Sometimes confuses the other actors. They come over hoping to see the hacked in governmental files. They just see, you're a divine child of God. Love and light surround you always. Angels and unicorns. Yeah, that's what's going on up in my head. Sorry to disappoint everybody. I didn't even watch 24 before I was on it, you know? I'm so happy that HGTV exists. I just leave it, like my favorite shows on HGTV are not even the ones where they're like, you know, we're running out of budget and there's a mold problem. Like even that is too intense for me. I like the one where they knock on the door and they're like, "Hi, we noticed your fence was falling apart. We'd like to redo your fence." And then the person's like, "Thank you." And that's the whole show. It's just them redoing the fence. I like stuff like that. So I'm a mom. Thank you very much. Oh, I know what I want to tell you. Thank you. Yeah, well, I'll take it. Applause for that. Yeah. So this is not a joke. I mean, okay, this, I get to just talk about my kids sometimes. That's what you get to do when you're a parent. So my son is six now. And okay, this is just is an example of, it starts out kind of cute funny, like kid funny, and then in the end it turns like searingly dark, brilliantly funny, I think. Tell me what you think. So my son's six, we're sitting on the couch, and we have dogs, and he farts, right? And then he's like, "Who farted?" And I go, "I don't know." And he goes, "Ah, the dogs." I'm like, "Yeah, those dumb dogs," like that. A couple minutes pass, and he goes, "It was me, Mom." And I start laughing, and I'm like, "Buddy, that's pretty funny." And I'm laughing, and he looks at me, and he goes, "Don't laugh, Mom." And I was like, "What? That was really funny, buddy." And he goes, "Mom, don't laugh at me, or I'll tell God to kill you." What? Like, I want to hang out with that guy when he grows up. I mean, I think he's either going to be great or diabolically evil. But I never said anything to him about that. But he put it together. That's what got. So never underestimate the six-year-old. Yeah, so it's exciting. I did not always want to be a mom. I wasn't one of those girls that was like, "Oh, I can't wait to be a mom." I was like, "I can wait, right?" Because I like to have a good time. But you know what happens when you have too good of a time? You get knocked up. What's up? Oh, hi. Hi, man. Maybe tonight this story will inspire you. I met my, maybe you can make a baby tonight. I'm getting ahead of myself. I met my husband. I was on stage at the Improv, and he was in the audience. And he comes up to me afterwards, and he was really good looking, and I was like done with men. I'm like, I'm over it, right? So he comes up to me. He's like, "Hey, could I get your number?" He's younger than me. He's like 9 years younger than me. And I was like, "What? You want my number?" Yeah, that's how I played it. It's pretty cool, right? Just extra C-wordy with him. I'm like, "Really? You want my number?" And I gave it to him once, verbally, and then drove away. And he called me. We got together. He remembered it. We got together. Made a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Sexually. And then 3 months later, I was pregnant. What's up? Hey. I'll be voting for the mayor of New York next term. One of my platforms is when the pullout becomes a push-in, vote for me. Get pregnant out of wedlock. Make a baby tonight. You guys, do it. So then my husband and I were able to have that wonderful romantic conversation that only two people who just met each other and decide to have a baby together can have, and it goes a little bit something like this. I don't want to have an abortion. Could I call you back? So he calls me back and he's like, "Listen, I don't want you to have an abortion either." And that's how two loving parents came together. Aww, you guys. Thank you very much. We're so happy you're here. We have a fantastic show for you. Please sit back, relax, and enjoy yourselves, and stick around. More to come. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. John Romanoff is taking the stage when we return.
Everybody. Hi, we're back. Listen, I feel really bad. Before the commercial break, I said that thing about my kid and how we can't. I just want to tell you something really sweet about my family real quick, so I don't leave that bad taste. Like, I don't like my son, because I like him now. I love him. Like, I would die for him. In fact, the other day I had a mental breakdown in the Whole Foods parking lot. Anyone? It's so stressful, right? My son was in the back seat on his iPhone, and you don't know how much they're listening or comprehending at that age. And I was just in the front seat like, oh, somebody took my parking spot, and just really spiraling downward, right? And I can't go in there, and I have no friends. And my son is in the back seat, and he just goes, hey, Mom, me and Dad are your friends. Aww. Right? Best thing ever. I just looked into his little face. I was like, oh, someone's getting a new app for their iPhone. So I love being a mom. So hey, everybody, here tonight making his TV debut, please give a warm, warm welcome for John Romanoff. Here he comes.
That is amazing. All right, cut the shit. Hello, New York. How are we doing? This is exciting. I'm on TV. I'm glad I skipped my Zumba class to be here for you people. No reason to be a dick, pal. Let's give me a break. I'm trying. I hated when fat people always, it always pissed me off when fat people would blame other people for why they were fat. It annoyed me, then I got fat, so now I'm gonna do it. I wanna blame the Mayans. Because they said the world was gonna end in 2012. So I was like, all right, fuck it, let's get a couple calzones over here. I only got a little bit of time. 2012 comes and goes, nothing. Now I'm just a fat dude. I got all this shit I gotta do, and it's expensive to get thin. It's cheap to get fat. Dollar menus all over the place. Weight Watchers cost $40 a month. $40! And all they do is watch. Honestly. You wanna hold my feet while I do sit-ups or something? Jerk off something, do something. Do you know that whiskey and Miller Lite have 3 points each? Oh good, you tabulate that at the end of the night? Because I'm shit-faced, I can't do it, so. If you want to do the accounting work, I'll take that. I'll do that. That's fine. I hate those. I hate the gym. I got to go to the gym, and my gym in my area is called the judgment-free zone. Yeah, it sucks. It's a bigger advertising fallacy than those fucking Mayans. It's ridiculous. And they judge me before. They judge me in the parking lot. I see him changing money like betting. He's not coming in here, though. He's not coming in here. Why would he be coming in here? And they always bring the fat asses to the elliptical machine because they say it's an impact-free exercise. They don't tell you they mean for the other machines. No, not the treadmill, pal. We don't have insurance for you on there. Come over here to this elliptical machine. We test this out on rhinoceri. You're gonna be fine right here on this. I'm realizing halfway through my workout, this is why they like fat people at the gym. Because it keeps us going. This is why they have pizza parties and Tootsie Rolls at my gym. Because they like the fat asses coming in the door. Because I realized halfway through my elliptical workout, right before I thought I was going to die, that not only was I sweating and dying, I was also providing the electricity for my entire portion of the gym. I had four TVs going, five banks of lights. Hipster dickheads are pulling up behind me and jacking their Priuses in. Get out of here. And it's like $10 a month for the gym. It seems reasonable. But the personal trainer costs $450 every half hour. And it's the same 5'2" jacked little douche nozzle who never got laid in high school, and now all he does is lift weights and scream at fat people for a living. No, what do you say to this little peckerhead? He just wants to scream at you. You know, I just want to get a little healthier, getting some of my old clothes. Maybe run around my daughter a little more in the yard. What are your goals? I just want to see my dick. I I miss it, you know? It wasn't much, but it was mine. I used to be able to see it whenever I wanted. Now I gotta use one of those mirrors they look for bombs under cars at the Olympics. I worked out today. My legs are shaking like a midget trying to hang a wall clock. It's terrifying. I have new goals now, one of which is to get in good enough shape to beat the shit out of my personal trainer. I hate him. I gotta get healthy though. I have a 4-year-old little girl, so I gotta get healthy. Hey, you're a warm audience. Guess if people who weren't on 24 have kids, nobody gives a shit, huh? 4-year-old's awesome. She's a lot of fun. Don't do that now. Nah, it's phony. She's fantastic. It's a lot of fun having a kid, especially when they get to like 3 or 4, so you can stop telling people how many months old they are. People with the months old, enough already. Look at Lily. She's 39 months old. Come on, how old is this fucking kid? Somebody... Give her $20. She's 39 months old. Don't make your friends do algebra to figure out how old your kid is. They don't want to hang out with you already because you got kids. My kid's 4. I know how old she is. I haven't slept in 4 years. I don't have sex. I can't have sex anymore. My wife leaves a piece of prime rib like this on the table. You believe that? Every time I want to fool around, she just points at the kid eating a penny off the rug and says, no, there it is. That's our special project. What are you, in a fucking union? We made one thing. Now you don't have to do anything forever? I don't have time for pornography because my kid sleeps 6 minutes at a time. Can't even take care of myself because I like the story to develop in my porno. I want to know how a girl got a plumber over to her house in 15 minutes. My basement flooded last year. If I got that kind of customer service, I'll suck a dick. I'm not afraid of it. Honestly. Hey, pal, I got water in the basement again. You saved my comic book collection. Same deal as last time. Gotta do it. My kid's smarter than me already. That sucks. I was driving around with her the other day, and she's in the back seat of the car, and I'm screaming at traffic, pissed off. She goes, Daddy, you gotta let it go. You give me advice from Frozen? Cut the shit. Don't give me advice. You lived in my balls 5 years ago. I have my daughter all the time now, and she's like my best little buddy to chill with. And all the time, we just sit there like she's really into Batman, which is fantastic because she's a little girl. She likes the princess shit too, but she loves Batman, and I love Batman. And I never really thought I'd hate it until I have to watch it 500 times a fucking day. And now it's just nothing but Batman all the time. And you start to break shit down when you watch it that much. Like, dude, you're 40 years old. I'm 40 years old. I have a mortgage. You're a billionaire. Go home. Cut the shit. Bang a supermodel and buy a Ferrari and leave these people alone. Had enough of your bullshit. You're running around, you got knee boots on with ears and a cape. Dressed like a Chelsea hooker. I don't get it. He hangs out with, you know, Commissioner Gordon and all these master criminals, and nobody's ever walked up to him and said, yo, Bruce, what the fuck are you wearing, dog? What is on your head?
This city needs me.
Shut up! Don't even talk like that! We all know it's you, the only one who can afford the fucking car. Holy shit, if I walked in, you guys have known me for like 8 minutes. If I walked in here right now and said,
this city needs me,
everybody would fucking know it was me. Everybody! Nobody'd say, hey, when did Batman get here and what'd he do with the comedian? Guys, my name's been John Romanoff. Thank you very much. I love you, Charlotte.
presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Oh, my gosh, everybody. What an amazing show. Please keep it going for our next comedian, also making his TV debut. Keep it going for James Goff, everybody. James.
Thank you. I read this interesting article I want to share with y'all. Let's start right there. I read this article about a homeless dude, right, who found $42,000 just laying around and gave it back to the cops. I know, wow, right? And I'm reading this story and I'm thinking to myself, he's stupid. Like, you're homeless. Isn't this what you pray for on your first day of being homeless? Like, you're sitting on a corner like, God, it's been 5 minutes. How do people do this for years? And then a bag of money appears and you give it back. No wonder you're homeless. You make homeless decisions. Not even the angel on your right shoulder would have agreed with you. He's like, keep the money and we need the shower. This is ridiculous. Just gonna have my wings sticking like this? Like, this is out of control. And you know what the cops gave him for his good deed? They gave him a paper award, and they framed it. Where the hell is he gonna hang it up at? I just don't think they thought that one out, is what I'm saying. I'm proud to say that I'm a proud father too. I just brought home a baby boy. Thank you. I say that to say this, man. Like, if you don't have kids, right? Don't have kids. Don't. It's not as much fun as you would think it would be, you know? Like, you know what I used to do before I had kids? Anything I wanted to do. It was awesome. Now, every morning, my daughter wakes me up like, Daddy, we hungry. I'm hungry too, like, yo, when is mom coming? We're about to die, like, every man for themselves. This just became the Hunger Games, like. And I didn't notice until I became a parent, but I figured out why parents age so quickly. It's because kids are parasites. They are. They drain you. They take your energy, your youthfulness, and then they use that to grow. Like, that's how kids get big. You didn't know that, right? I didn't either. But it explains a lot. It explains why deadbeat dads always look amazing. And the funny thing is, I used to judge them. Like, you ain't no man. A real man, he takes care of his responsibilities. You ain't no man. And then I had kids, and I was like, who the hell am I to judge? What I need to do is mind my business. That's what I need to do. I do not know that man's troubles. I see some of the women looking at him like, oh my God, he must be a horrible father. I'm actually an awesome dad. It's just that I'd rather be an uncle. It's not all bad, though. There are some perks. It took me a couple of years to think of one, but there are some. Like, I get to see all the Disney Pixar movies when they first come out. That's kind of cool. Because before, it was just me. It was kind of creepy. It's just be me and a bunch of parents, and they looking at me, and I'm looking back like, this is going to be good. Popcorn, anybody? I got a girl, man, I didn't want her. Yeah, don't laugh, ladies, your dad didn't want you either. I know, it hurts. I see the look on your face, like, why would you say that, chocolate? All right, let me rephrase this, sweetie, look. Your dad loves you. Like, I love my daughter. I would die for her. You understand what I'm saying? I would die for her. I just didn't want her. Like, you know what dads think about when we have girls? We think about all the stuff we did to mom to get you here. And now I know there's somebody out there that's gonna try to do it to her. And I'm never gonna be okay with it. She can be happily married. I'm still gonna wanna stab this dude in the eye with a turkey knife. And he has no idea. He's like, Dad, can you pass the gravy? Hell no. Ask me to pass you some gravy. You ain't asked to have sex with my daughter, so don't ask me to pass you no gravy. Apparently, you know how to help yourself. Why don't you do it? Like, I'm worried about the boyfriend. She's three. I'm already there. I'm already thinking about what I'm going to do. And I figured it out. He's going to come in, try to be all polite. Like, shut up, you little punk. Now, get over here. Now, I want you to understand something. That's my baby girl upstairs. She looks just like me. She's a piece of me. So when you take her out tonight, you think about kissing and caressing and touching her. I want you to know one thing, that if you do any, and I mean any, of those things, it's kind of like you're doing them to me. My kids are mixed. They're mixed. They're Russian, black, and Jewish. Yeah. So you know what that means. Scholarships. People hear that, they're like, a black guy with a Jewish girl? Like, that's unheard of. That's like catching a leprechaun. It's amazing. Like, Jay-Z don't even have one of those. It worked out the way I planned. When we get married, I'm taking her last name. Yeah, walking to that first meeting, we're looking for James Weinstein. Yeah, I know it's confusing. I'm black Jewish, yeah. You want me to prove it? Mazel tov. Be a sexy Jew, too. Dressed in all black with like a blinged out Star David chain. Rocking a Yankee fitted yarmulke on. Cruising through my neighborhood, checking property, raising rent, you know, doing what I'm doing. My ultimate goal with this whole family thing is to provide for my family everything that I never got. All the love, all the attention, all the money. Yeah, that's right. I can't wait to get rich. Now, I know what's going to happen when I get rich. All the people who didn't believe in me are going to try to give me advice. Not even good advice. Horrible advice. Stuff like, yo, Jay, whatever you do, don't forget where you come from, son. That's funny because that's exactly what I'm going to do. Yeah. When Michael Jackson got rich, he didn't collect the weapons Joe Jackson beat his behind with and make a museum called Remember the Times. No. He brought a monkey, a giraffe, and a roller coaster. I'm just saying, if I was in your position, I just wouldn't let money change me. Change me? It's gonna change my address, my phone number, my clothes. I'm not supposed to know you. I'm in a different tax bracket. I'm a Republican now. That's been all my time. I appreciate y'all.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Joe Sib is taking the stage when we return.
Fantastic show. I love that everybody's getting into it about their kids and just the dirty side of having kids. I love that. I feel I can relate to James, except I'm the mom and I had the kid. I had an emergency C-section. Woo! Oh, yeah. But when you have a C-section, you're out of it, you know? Like, I'm on drugs, someone else is holding the baby. So I had this moment of realization. I was like, oh, is that the baby? That's it? Okay. I don't like it. Yeah, I don't care for that. Can we is there a receipt or something? Because we... Yeah, it was a little touch and go.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Nick Griffin is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, our final comedian of the night. He's hilarious. You've seen him on David Letterman. Please give a round of applause for Nick Griffin.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Yeah. Oh, thanks. That's nice of you. I appreciate that. Thanks for coming. I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you. Yeah, proud of you for getting out of the house. Hard to get out of the house these days, isn't it? So much good shit in the house. Computer, TV, phone, food, couch, bed, heat. Outside the house, people. Yeah. And not even the good kind. It's not like you're walking outside running into Bradley Cooper and Halle Berry. It's the B team out there. Yeah, it's the JV. Drunk, loud, boring, confused. It's like a giant Greyhound bus just unloaded right in front of you. Do you know where I can plug in my thing with that? And look, I'm a compassionate person. I love people, but and I know people are doing the best they can, but it's just not very good. Right? I think that's why so many people from other countries want to come over here. They're watching us going, Jesus, I can do better than that. Come on, people, no one has any patience anymore. Have you noticed that about us? As a society, we have zero patience. You seen us waiting in line these days? Anywhere? It's unbelievable. There's people all over the world waiting hours in the desert heat for a cup of rice or a jug of water. We get into that Starbucks checkout line, and after 9 seconds, what the fuck is going on up there? Why aren't we moving? I got cold air coming right down on my head. I'm gonna tweet this. Everybody is in a hurry now. Everyone! You can just see it in people's faces when they're waiting in line. Everyone's got that same energy when they're waiting in line, that... God! Why are there other people here? Because it's Earth. And we fuck a lot. I think that should be our new flag. Just a picture of a guy. Son of a bitch! America. Right? Because that's all anyone wants anymore. We just want whoever is standing in front of us to fucking go! My way.
I have to get home and do absolutely nothing! I was supposed to be doing nothing 20 minutes ago! I'm exhausted from doing something. I'm the same way, I'm just like you. I don't want to do anything. I don't want to leave the apartment, man. If I was under house arrest, it would have zero effect on my daily schedule. Would actually open things up a bit, really. I don't know what to do. I called my buddy today. I said, do you want to go out to lunch? He said, I can't, I'm taking a bath. I said, that's okay, I'm not hungry anymore. Why would a man tell another man he's taking a bath? Look, I know women take baths, it's fine, but a guy, what are you, a old prospector in the 1800s? Come into town for a shave and a whore? He was taking a bath. What's he gonna do after that? Light a candle and write in his journal? Yeah, I don't know. I did get talked into going to a concert recently. That was, you done that? That's a young person's game. It's just too much waiting, you know? It's just, ugh. Gotta wait to get into the concert, then you gotta wait for a drink, then you gotta wait for the band. Before the band comes out, that guy comes out before every concert, doesn't matter what concert. Are you ready to rock? Yes, of course we're ready to rock. We paid for parking, we bought a ticket. I mean, you have the guitar. Are you ready to rock? Because
I can't hear you.
Yeah, you can. You can hear me. It's a music hall. It was built for acoustics. Now you're lying. Now I don't want to go to the show. Are you ready to rock? I guess when you're young, you know, and somebody says, are you ready to rock? You're like, oh my God, I am ready to rock. But when you're older, you got shit to do. It's like, just fucking go. You see through all that stuff when you get older. Concerts, the lead singer comes out, doesn't matter what city you're in. We love this town. Fuck you. There's hundreds of apartments available here. If you wanted to, you could move here. Of course you love this town. You make $100,000, you do an orgy, and you leave. Yeah. I'd love Toledo, too, if that was my itinerary. I don't know. I just got to get it together. I'm trying to pull it together. Divorced, dating, trying to... I just got out of a relationship. That didn't work out. I think I got into it too quickly. If I get into another relationship, I'm going to go slow, like really slow. Like I'm just going to fucking skip it. So you guys are young. People are young. You're young. It's nice when you're young. Dating, it's good. Yeah, it's young. The dating pool, it's fresh. It's clean. I'm 25 years down the line. It's a dirtier pool. My pool is murky. You know, everyone's tired and fucking damaged and heavily medicated. It's not even dating, it's like volunteer work, you know? Thank you very much, that's all from me, I gotta go.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City.
Everybody, thanks so much for coming out tonight. Oh my gosh. Thank you for supporting live comedy. Thank you everybody at home who also supported live comedy. We love you. Come back again. Good night. Keep it up for all of our comedy.